Now, these dogs that you're training, you know, Phoebe was like, that was very interesting listening to how effective. Yeah. Are you using Belgian Malinois? Is that what you're using?
Yeah, primarily our main dog's a Belgian Mal. And
those are powerful dogs, man.
They are amazing.
They're so smart.
Yeah.
You look in their eyes and they're like,
you
hey,
can
man.
See it, right?
Yeah, they're like, hey, man, how you
yeah.
doing?
Yeah, yeah.
They're not like looking at a poodle.
No, they're not like looking at our labs. Not
they
Marshall
look
or
right
Apollo.
Through you.
Oh, looking
yeah,
at you
like,
with
hey,
that
sweetie.
Sweet little face.
Yeah,
hey.
No, those dogs.
Tongue out. Yeah.
Yeah.
The thing that's cool about these dogs, and I can't talk enough about it, man, because no matter where you sit, everybody loves a good dog story. And, you know, some people say, well, dual purpose, you got to bite guys. What's with that? Is it, you know, really aggressive? And when you look at it, it's a lifesaver for everybody. It's a lifesaver for us. It's a lifesaver for the suspect, too, because it usually involves a potential gunfight that the dog basically, you know, alleviated because she or he was there. So we got our canine program in agency going kind of full speed around 2008-ish. And we had three levels of canine. We have like the companion ride along canine that kind of does everything with you. She's never going to bite anybody. And that's Apollo. That's like my lab, right? And then we have the detection level dog. And most of those are Labradors like Marshall, like Apollo, because labs have such amazing noses. They really can hold on scent. You know, they can train to detect many scents, and we certify them in different things. And then there's the Phoebes. You know, the Belgian Mals or the Shepherds, and really it's become mostly Mals now in our agency. And
why Mals over Shepherds?
They just do better in the heat. You know, Shepherds are longer haired,
right.
And we're in 100-degree weather. We're on long hikes, you know, we're unsupported, and those dogs might have to sit quietly after hiking 8 miles and sit in a prone quietly while we're watching and observing and stalking in on suspects to make an apprehension and an arrest safely and hopefully avoid a gunfight. So, and we've also found with the Mals, like I said, they just hold up better on average, and there's certainly exceptions to that. But when we got our dual purpose program back on track, these are dogs that will bite when they need to on command, but they have great noses, so they'll still detect wonderfully, you know, finding evidence, finding tainted weed, whatever the case may be, a firearm, a bear gallbladder, all of that. But they'll also, you know, like Phoebe was nicknamed the fur missile because when it was time for her to go to work and some guy was going to pull a weapon on us, she was all business. And the cool thing about a dog like her, and Mike Ritland and I got into this on his show especially, and he was blown away. He said, I've never heard of a dog in a domestic law enforcement team that's had like, she had 116 apprehension bites in her career. And she had
116.
No joke, Joe.
So there's 116 cartel guys out there telling stories about this dog.
Yeah, they're saying no more Perro. I've been bit too many times. No, but the cool thing about that was the standpoint of life she saved, and she also arrested another 800 to 900 that she didn't have to bite in her career. That's a lot.
How many have you guys arrested?
When I retired, we were over 1,000.
Wow.
In 5.5 years. Yeah, and we. And again,
all grow ops.
All grow ops. Yeah, these are all grow ops or related to grow ops.
So the
and these are all guys that are armed, all guys that have knives or guns, you know,
yeah.
That you're not getting bit unless, you know, you're a deadly force threat on some level or a significant threat. So, yeah, it's been a lot of guys.
So that number that you're talking about, 10,000, that really is conservative.
I think very much so. Yeah.
That is so insane because if you fly over like Humboldt or any of these areas, like particularly Mendocino, Northern California, the density of the forest and the public land out there, there's a lot of land.
There's a lot of land and a lot of potential we're not seeing. So and that's still thriving. So when you when you look at Phoebe as a canine and you go, well, let's see, she was in the field doing these type of operations for about 7 or 8 years. And yeah, that's great from a record standpoint and numbers and the life she saved, but it gives you like a snapshot of the issue. How many guys did we not catch that were out there armed that way that we weren't involved in, you know, that we weren't involved. So, and the dogs have just saved lives, man. They have saved Phoebe. I go into this in the new book, especially in 2012, but right before our team started, Phoebe saved my life, Brian's life, and all these other operators in Santa Clara County in Silicon Valley, right? Where I grew up, because she engaged a guy that was pulling a Russian automatic pistol on me, and I was the support for Brian. I was basically his canine handler or support guy. And Brian had to deal with this other grower's partner that had a big Taurus Judge revolver on his hip, and he was pulling it. So he goes for that guy and says, John, just take my dog. And Phoebe's on the bite, and he's biting this guy in the calf. And, you know, this guy's nose down, and we don't know he's got this weapon. And I start to see it coming out. And I get on him and I do what I need to do with some physical control and some strikes and whatnot to get the gun out of his hand. But had she not been on that guy on a bite show, that gun's turned on me at 5 feet. I'm engaged, all the riflemen behind me. I'm in a gunfight again. We've been in too many of those already.
How many gunfights have you been in?
Our team's been in six. And I've been on the ground for four out of the six that our guys have been involved in. And they've all been around this particular problem. We had a lot less once the team got formalized and so we started using dogs, but we still had two during the window of the team being operational that we couldn't avoid. And dogs played a big part in that, as I go into in the new stories.
It is so great. I mean, when I was listening to that podcast with Steve Rinella, the Meat Eater podcast with you, and I was like, I can't believe that there's not some sort of another division of law enforcement that gets involved in this and that we're requiring game wardens. Yeah. To essentially become something completely different.
Yeah.